Hey, this is Darren LaCroix with another unforgettable interview. It's so hard to stand out in the speaking world. And so I'm sitting down now with Ed Tate, the 2000 world champion of public speaking, and one of the people that I believe is the most talented in engaging an audience, getting them up and moving around. And maybe we'll tell the Belgium story later, Ed. But Ed Tate, you got stuck in this situation. We had to put together a world-class presentation in like 48 hours, and they changed it up on you just before. And this is a high-paid keynote. Mm-hmm. So, Ed Tate, welcome to Unforgettable Interviews.
I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to be here. So,
Go ahead.
A situation where a client said, okay, you're going to have this topic. And then, like you said, 48 hours before I'm actually supposed to be giving this presentation, they says, oh, you know, you've got a new topic. And what I'm going to do is describe to you the process I use to create TED-like talk. They were like micro talks, if you will, creating that process in a very short period of time.
So you obviously have been speaking for a long time, and this was, though, not one of your standard speeches.
It's not, yeah.
And so what, first of all, what goes through your thought process when they change it up on you last minute?
Well, you know, I felt I still had time. I still had some time to do it. And the topic that they chose was courage. So courage is a topic that I like, and I knew I had some content. So for example, like, you know, one thing you always talk about is having speaker file. Well, my speaker file is electronic, and I use Evernote, and I use tags. So literally I went to Evernote, and it's like my treasure trove of all my information, and I just typed in courage. And I literally had about 40 or 50 items in there already.
Oh, cool.
I had a series of quotes. I had some fragments of some speech ideas that I had. I had a couple of exercises and tools. It was like a hodgepodge, but I had raw material to work with.
Mm. So I was like, raw material that you collected, that you already liked, you already approved.
I've been doing this, you know, collecting this information literally for years.
And so one of the key topics to making this happen quickly, or one of the key insights, is actually starting your story file and having a Word document, and you do it in Evernote.
I do it in Evernote, yep. Because Evernote, it's almost like a search engine, if you will. It's a search engine for all your content and your information. Obviously, you can record text in there, but you know, like for today, we went to the National Speakers Association here in Las Vegas. I actually recorded the entire meeting. I was actually taking notes and recording the meeting at the same time. Later on, what I need to do is I need to put in tags for that particular meeting. So whenever I do a search on it, I can talk will come up again.
So in Evernote, you actually put in, like you're saying, tags, but just to help everybody understand. So you have a story and you're thinking in your mind when you come up or create your tags, this could be courage, this could be humor.
It could be multiple tags, yes. So exactly what you just said. It could be courage, it could be fear. Like usually fear and courage go hand in hand. I actually pulled up, I did another search on fear because, you know, courage, you know, the opposite of that is, you know, it's fear. So the content that came up with regard to that. So step number one is have a story file, like Darren always talks about. Step number two is, again, I prefer Evernote. The point is, it doesn't matter which tool you use, have a tool.
Yeah, I just use a simple Word document, but whatever, I always love to say the most valuable tool is the one that you use and you're comfortable with.
Absolutely.
Evernote works for you, beautiful. But for all speakers, I think they need to have this and keep this and keep updating it on a regular basis. How often do you think you update your Evernote?
I use Evernote every single day.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, for one reason or another. For example, now I've gotten into the habit, if there's a quote that I hear, or, you know, I'll be watching something or I get a speech idea, my goal now is to actually put it into Evernote. So electronically, I could reach out to it. I'm a journaler, so I have at least 30 journals. The bad side of having paper journals is, okay, which journal was it in?
Search engine.
The physical pages. And the thing is,
now the search engine.
Exactly. But here's a clue. Evernote, you can actually scan the pages and, again, use tags. And they actually have some type of software in there that actually reads some of your handwriting, not all of it. But anyway, that's the reason I'm committed to Evernote, because if I want to find something quickly,
makes it easier. So just a quick, for people who haven't done this, how many tags on average would you say for each of your stories or story ideas? Is it one or two? Is it 12?
I'm going to say it ranges from, it's usually more than two tags. I'm going to say on average from 3 to 7 is a number of tags per idea, per concept, per piece of content.
And so when you're tagging this, when you have this idea, you write out the story file or write out the story or the details from the story. Well, let's ask you, what do you put in there?
Okay. So like, again, I have quotes, you know, that may have these tags, or I may have a rough idea of a story. For example, I have this one story, it's called, I call it the backstory. So about a couple of years ago, for the first time ever, I injured my back. Now for my friends who've always had back, chronic back pain, and I always told them, like, you know, suck it up, princess. karma, you know, karma came off. And the pain was so bad that the only place I could actually be comfortable was laying on the floor.
Mm.
Now, the problem with getting up the floor, laying on the floor, eventually you got to get up. I'll let you come up with the reason why you got to get up, but eventually you got to get up, okay? So my first method of getting up was, you know, I mentally, I would try to move here. Oh, that hurts. And I was trying to do this weird type of limbo dance to get up to see if I could avoid the pain. Mm-hmm. And it didn't work. And eventually one time I was sitting on the floor. I says, you know, when I go into the pool, I just don't ease into the pool. I dive into the pool. So what would happen if I just got up? So one time I actually timed myself trying to do this limbo dance versus just getting up. It took me 5 minutes doing the limbo, but it only took me about 5 seconds if I just got up right away.
Wow.
Let's see, 5 minutes is 300 seconds. It took me 100 times longer.
Mm.
100 times longer. So the point is that I try to make from this rough draft story is sometimes you got to giddy up, grimace, and go. You know? You got to just go through the pain. So anyway, that's an Evernote. This rough idea. First of all, I had a backache. I said, okay, there's a lesson here someplace, you know. By the way, I didn't write this story until I was actually healed from a back injury. Okay, right. And it did, because like it would have hurt too much.
But anyway, story plus time.
Yeah. So I put in. So what are some lessons here? So okay, this is pain. How we try. I wrote down the word avoidance. How we try to avoid things.
So these are the tags you came up with.
Yeah, these are tags I came up with. Facing your fear. And then I just came up with this alliteration, giddy up, grimace, and go. And that turned out to be the point of the story. You know, in that particular case.
All right. So this is important because you didn't just sit down and start writing the speech and have 2 days to do this. You immediately went to the story file. So story file, your most important inventory. All right. So take us through the process. What did they say to you and what went through your brain?
So initially I had collaboration. So that was the original topic they wanted me to talk about. And again, this is a TED-like talk. Now for you TED purists, you know, lighten up. Okay. So this is TED-like, you know, I'm not, you know, what I'm about to show you is not an actual TED talk. I know TED talks are very specific. They got very specific rules. In this particular case, we were doing that.
And to clarify for you, for people watching this, Ed, you didn't just start 2 days early. They changed the rules 2 days early.
Yes.
Big difference between procrastinating and the client says, oh, by the way.
Well, and this was a referral from a speaker pal of mine, you know, people you may know, Craig Valentine. And so I didn't want to disappoint him. So I started working on this project right away. I mean, there was like no procrastination whatsoever. Sure. And I wanted to get a jump on it. And
peer pressure.
Part of my process is I need sleep. So if I'm working on a project, you know, I'll write my rough ideas, you know, a couple of weeks, you know, down the road, I mean, early. And then I want to get some sleep, and then I want to look at those ideas with fresh eyes, and then I'll make adjustments, and I want to repeat that process. So that's part of my process is I need to get sleep and look at it again with fresh eyes. I need to go away for a while, come back to it. Does that make sense?
There's a power to that, for sure.
There's definitely a power to that. So anyway, they said, okay, 2 days before the thing, you've got courage. So go to Evernote right away.
And you're like, what?
You know, I'm not going to do it. And the other thing is, I'm a professional. This is my job. This is what I do for a living.
Mm.
So you know what? You know, this is what pros do.
Remember, they were trying to help people. We're being talking about becoming unforgettable. Tell us the truth. Did you panic for a half a second?
Well, you know, I did pee about that much.
Okay, we're being this the open, unvarnished truth.
Well, you said be honest. Okay.
Okay.
Well, it was like momentary panic, but like again, I had it. This is, I like the topic. I actually like the change of the topic. I have more content on courage than I did on collaboration. You know.
Okay.
So for me, this was like a blessing. You know, I'm thinking like, cool. The challenge was I had so much content and my talk was only 10 to 15 minutes what to put into it.
Mm.
That was a hard part. It wasn't finding the content. It was what content is going to go in this and so that you can have some type of cohesive message. Plus the other thing is I also had to tie it into their theme, which was unstoppable. So my TED talk or my, you know, micro talk is on courage, but the theme is unstoppable. So how do I combine that? So I'm a visual learner and I like to use a mind map. So can I show
please,
you?
Please show us. Yes.
So hopefully we can see this. How's that look?
We're cutting off the bottom just a little.
Okay. So
let me
just adjust that.
Okay. You got it. Perfect. Okay. Yep.
All right. So this is a mind map. Okay, so if you've never seen a mind map before, just Google it, okay? So in this case, this is the main topic. The topic is going to be on courage. And these legs, if you will, are different categories that I always use when I'm creating a speech. So the top one are the objectives. So I'm just going to call out each one of these main topics, and then I'm going to go into detail. So objectives. What are not only are the objectives of the speech, but what are my personal objectives? So what are the client's objectives or what I call stated objectives and what are my personal objectives as well, okay? The premise, and that is, what am I gonna say specifically about courage? What's gonna be my opening line? What's gonna be my big idea? So like in the TED Talk, you got one big idea. So in this case, what's gonna be the big idea around courage? Then, okay, what stories am I going to use? So in my case, 10 minutes, this is like, you know, for those of you Toastmasters, okay, cool. That's you know, for me, that's one story, or it could be a couple stories. So what stories I'm gonna use? I also want to incorporate a tool, or some, what can people do? What's the next step for people in terms of dealing with courage, or how can they deal with courage? How I'm gonna close the presentation, what's the theme? Again, the theme was unstoppable, and then what are some possible quotes I could use? So this is like my basic, think of this as a visual outline. And this is how I think. Again, I'm a visual learner and this helps me. And the thing I like about this is, here is my sloppy first copy, okay? And I, as you can see, it is very, very sloppy, all right? So let's talk about some of the objectives. Some of the objectives were to, okay, I want to combine the topic and the theme. So the theme is unstoppable and the topic is courage. Eventually what I came up with, my opening line was, I said, courage is a secret sauce. That it's that one thing that'll make you unstoppable. So that was my opening line, that was my opening premise. It'll improve your confidence and it only takes a few seconds. And then that was my transition into my stories. Now, again, going through my Evernote file, I actually had four or five different stories. I had the Pretty Ricky story. I had the back pain story, which I just told you just now. Mm-hmm. I had there's a Regina Oliver story, Do It Scared story, okay? So I had four or five stories to pick from on my first draft. Then from there, I had some tools. So what are some of the tools? One tool is called the reversal of desire. Another tool is called the 5-second rule. Another tool is called the 5-minute rule, the 2-minute rule, and the 20-second rule. So I had all these different tools that
use the 5-second rule?
I did use the 5-second rule.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Well, I told the audience, I says, hey, when I first got into the speaking business, it was a 5-minute rule. Then it became the 2-minute rule. Then it became the 20-second rule. Today, it's the 5-second rule. And the audience laughed. But those are different tools in terms of how to deal with courage. And then I didn't know exactly how it was going to close, to be honest with you. So I just kind of left that open. And then I had a whole series of quotations. Okay, so let's look at some of the first draft here. And I had quotes around the comfort zone because that was one of the sub themes was break out of your comfort zone. And I discovered that during the pre-session call with the client. So they kept mentioning comfort zone, comfort zone, comfort zone. We want our people to break out of their comfort zone. So I said, okay, I'm going to keep that in mind. So here's a couple of quotes I came up with, again, from Evernote. Nothing great happens from the comfort zone. This comes from Mike Rayburn. We just saw him do rebirth. The comfort zone is, when you're in your comfort zone, the only thing you do is coast, and it's always downhill. Comfort zones lead to coffins. Courage is not the absence of fear, but rather the judgment that something else is more important than fear. So I put a star behind on that one. I said to myself, that one feels good. You know, I says, I can see people going, So again, I had a whole series of quotes, and I posted all those quotes right here. Let's go back to the objectives. Again, let's see, combine the topic and the theme, break out of your comfort zone, let's have fun. I want to make it memorable. The personal objective, I want to be invited back. Ideally, I wanted to have two spinoffs, personal objective. Now, I would never share that with the client, but this is my own personal objective.
Well, but at the same time, your motivation to be so good is going to be covered, and they're going to benefit from that as well. Yeah. So it's self-serving, but at the same time, it's client-serving.
And because I want to be invited back, guess what? I have to be really, really good. And then, so you and I just saw Mike Rayburn, Hall of Fame speaker, do a presentation on being a virtuoso. And I love that idea. So I put down, give a virtuoso performance. And I put underneath that, what would make this a virtuoso performance? So for 2 days, I processed on that question. And sometimes I would be driving down the street, and all of a sudden I would had an idea, and I would pull over, and I would write it down.
Evernote.
I would be in the shower, this Evernote. Is this, So, just processing in the question, ideas kept coming up. And then the other thing that this TED Talk was about was preparing them for a 90-minute meeting. So, I needed to find out what was happening in that 90-minute meeting. So, and that helped me select some things. So, again, we've got my premise, courage is the secret sauce, and then I had to pick the stories. So I went through all my story files, and I said, okay, which story really is about courage? So my back pain story, I can't say that's about courage. I can't say I'm being brave just by standing up. It's kind of cute. Maybe I can use that story sometime later, but not here. But the Pretty Ricky story was a time in my life when I was painfully shy. Now, for those of you at home, I've since gotten over it, okay? But at the time, I was painfully shy, and I had a cousin, and he was one of the cool kids, and he was one of the most popular guys in the entire school, and his nickname was Pretty Ricky. Some of you have heard me tell the Pretty Ricky story before, but, Ricky, we would go to parties, and girls would unsolicited hand him phone numbers. And, remember like how you used to go trick-or-treating, and you would separate the good candy from the bad candy?
Of course.
With the phone numbers, He would like throw them up in the air, let it rain, and then he'd separate the phone numbers, And that's how pretty he was. Well, anyway, in this story, he knew that I liked a girl by the name of Lita Barnes. She was a class valedictorian, a cheerleader, and that day she had been named the prom queen. How's that working out for a really shy guy?
Intimidating.
Yeah, exactly. So Ricky on this day knew I liked that. And he said, let me ask you a question. Question number one, is she going out with you now? I said, no. If you ask her and she says no, will she be going out with you in the future? I said, no. So your circumstances haven't changed. Right? I said, yeah. He says, Eddie, if you ask her and she says yes, then everything changes. And then he said, don't you say no before they say no. Never take yourself out of the game. Don't tap out. Always ask.
Pretty Ricky's pretty smart.
Well, that's the only wisdom ever I got from him. That was it. That was his whole game.
Hey, he made it into your story file. So
exactly. So I said to myself, that's a story I think really resonates with courage. And then,
In a way, you're like, I've heard you use the term before. Yeah. You're taking all the stories, and now you have to narrow it down. So you call it has to audition its way in. Is that what you say?
I think that's actually Mike Rayburn's phrase.
Oh, okay.
It's got to work its way in. Yeah.
So you do the top, the final four.
I do. It's called the main draw. Like for those of you who watch basketball or any type of tournament where player A plays player B, C, D, and et cetera, I pair them off against each other. So in this case, the Pretty Ricky story and the Regina Alba story are really, really similar. Those are two stories where I had a crush on the girl and I was afraid to ask them out. Okay. But between the two, the Pretty Ricky story was more powerful. So I would do that process of elimination so I can pick my content. And I did that with all these different other pieces of the content, especially with the tools as well.
So Ed, I just want to show something real quick. So, I'm hoping this comes out. So what Ed is saying is it's really hard to look at four stories and just pick one. What Ed was doing,
yep.
I don't know if you can see that, is taking the four stories and pitting this one against this one. Which one's stronger?
Yep.
Like, especially if they're similar. Yeah, for this situation, this one's stronger. So that gets to there. Okay, this one versus this one. Yep. Out of those two, that one goes there. Okay, now these two, if we can fit two in, then obviously we want both of them. But if we can't, out of these two. So I just wanted to explain that a little.
Perfect. And that's the exact process that I use. And I felt this story was the strongest story. I felt that it was a story that had the most humor. I also felt that it was a sales group. So one thing about selling is sometimes salespeople take themselves out of the game. I actually quoted Patricia Fripp. The answer is always no if you don't ask. Mm. So I actually added that to the story as well, that little quotation. So I said, out of all the stories, that's the strongest story. That's the story I'm going with. Boom. It's got the strongest story. It's fun. And it makes the strongest point. Okay. Tools. So I had a couple of tools. And I didn't want to sound like other speakers. I didn't want to repeat other ideas that other people have heard of before.
And if I can pause you for a quick second right there. So we're talking about being unforgettable.
Yes.
And here's the key is that you're at a conference and the theme is unstoppable.
Yep.
You've given the specific topic of courage, but what you have to be careful is if you have unstoppable, you want to make sure that you're not using the same, let's say, cliche or overused quotes as everybody else. That's how you stand out and look professional, and that's how you become unforgettable.
And that's the challenge too.
Mm.
That's the challenge. So for example, there are some other quotes that came up, you know, like this one quote is, you know, courage is not the absence of fear, it's taking action. It's not the absence of fear, it's taking action in the face of fear. Well, that's almost like a cliche now, because mm-hmm. pretty much everyone's heard that one. It's on the internet, you know, it's on Facebook, etc. And even though that is a very strong statement,
we've heard it before. Yeah,
because it sounds like a cliche.
Sure.
And people have heard it before. And again, going back to comfort zone. So this tool called the reversal desire is, and we've done this at Lady in the Champs in the past, it's a really crazy idea, okay? And the crazy idea is step number one is you identify an area that you've been avoiding. Okay, so something you haven't been dealing with, all right? And a conversation you need to have or an action you need to take, etc. By the way, once you've identified that, guess what? We've identified your comfort zone. That's what your comfort zone is. It's these areas that you've been, you designed your life in such a way that you don't have to confront whatever that thing you've been avoiding, okay? So that number one, you identify that. So step one of reversal desire is, you know, bring it on. So I literally have the audience stand up and say, bring it on. Again,
of course.
Number one, it goes back to my objectives. Number one, be memorable. Number two, have fun. Number three, have the audience a part of the crowd and break your comfort zone. So this audience, they're not used to standing up and saying, bring it on, you know, and they're really not comfortable with the next statement. And the next statement is, oh man, if you thought that one was bad, the next statement is this. Okay, so now I want you to step into this thing that you've been avoiding, you know, pretend it's a cloud. I want you to step into the cloud. The next statement that you say with an enthusiasm is, I love pain. Now, usually, man, I wish I would have had a camera. The moment they usually see the looks on these people's faces, and they're going, I love pain. Just as with P, I love pain. And they do it. And then the third step is pain sets me free. And the point I'm trying to, and then I have them seated, and that's just the point is, you need to confront whatever it is, you know? So the reason I chose this one as opposed to something a little bit more conservative is because we want them to be unstoppable. It goes back to the sub theme of confronting the, you know, dealing with the comfort zone. I want to make it fun. I also want to make it remarkable or memorable. Okay. Mm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that's helped me choose that one. I says, okay, I got to tell you, out of all the things I put on here, this is the one that made me the most nervous. It really, really did. Even for me. Because I'm thinking like, okay, I'm here on the behalf of another speaker, a good friend of mine. I don't want to be so crazy that it, you know, I had that. If it was just me, I don't have any problems whatsoever.
But no,
I was,
you have somebody else's reputation is on the line.
Yeah, so that's the thing that had me hesitant. And I let him know what I was going to do, and he said, you know, go for it. Okay, so, all right. And so, again, I picked my, using that main draw process, that's how I selected that one quote. Courage is not the absence of fear, but is a judgment that something's more important than fear. Okay, so that's the quote I was going to use. And then the close I was going to use was, I debrief the reversal of desire, why this helps you confront courage, and why it is a courage on demand type of tool. And anytime you feel nervous, etc., go through those steps. But if you don't feel comfortable doing that, there's a simpler process. And the simpler process is, in this case, I did bring up the 5-second rule. I says, this is Mel Robbins' idea. And her idea is anytime that you feel nervous about anything, she says, what you do is you count down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. And whatever it is, you charge towards what it is. So what I had the audience do in this case is, okay, everyone hold up your hand and count down with me. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And everyone says, go. And everyone said, go. And it says, with that, and I literally ended 15 minutes on the nose. Now it's time for you to go to your next session. And it worked out. It worked out beautifully.
Smooth.
But the point I'm trying to make is, this is how I created it. So, and this is like, this is version, what you're saying is a clean version. Version 1.0, like I said before, it was a sloppy first copy.
It works though.
2.0, slightly better, you know, not that much neater. Then I finally got to this version right here. And this is the version that you see right here.
So within 48 hours, you came up with 3 versions.
Well, I had version 1.0.
Yep.
And then, I had version 1.0. And I said, okay, how is this going to flow? And then my goal was that day before I went to bed, I wanted to have, I had this structure. Okay, so this structure, this was done. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how it was going to close. I had determined which story I was going to go with. My objectives were already clear. I didn't know exactly which quotes I wanted to use yet. So the unfinished parts were the quotations and how it was going to close. Woke up the next morning, I had better clarity. I says, okay, this doesn't work. This doesn't work. I did some rearranging. Mm-hmm. And then the day before the presentation, I says, okay, it's called freezing the design. And like in engineering, like, you know, if like, I've got to start reading, you know, readers now, but engineers design this. Okay. And eventually there comes a point where the engineers had to freeze the design and this had to actually be launched into the marketplace. Well, same thing with your presentation and your speech. Okay. You just have to freeze the design. And I literally, okay, Darren, I don't know if I'm just going to read this to the audience. Mm-hmm. The design got frozen. I literally wrote on here, freeze the design, 1:45 p.m. That was on the 10th of this month. I wrote down, design is frozen.
At what time were you speaking?
Let's see. Actually, the following day in the afternoon.
Okay. So you took a day to internalize it. You're like, okay, that's it. Done. No more changes.
No more changes.
I got to own it.
Yep. So that's when I started practicing and rehearsing. So that afternoon at 1:45, I actually practice version 1.0 of this new presentation from about 2 o'clock until about six. Took off for a couple hours, and I said, I want to have a couple other videotaped rehearsals before I go to bed.
Wow.
Because I wanted to go to bed with this on my mind. Then I woke up the next morning, and I mean, it was just, I don't know what it was, but it was like I was on fire. So I was like, okay, oh, I can do this. I can do this. So, you know, the next day was a travel day. No, I'm sorry, yeah. The next day was a travel day. And I woke up that morning, again, I practiced the entire day. You know, I was like, I would be in line, you know, waiting, you know, at TSA, you know, courage is not the absence of fear, but, and I'm moving and I'm practicing different parts of the presentation throughout the entire day.
Is that the one where you're practicing in the police officer?
Oh, yes. This is hilarious. This is funny. I forgot where I was driving. But I live in Las Vegas and it's illegal to text and drive. You can't have your cell phones. And so I pull up to this stop sign and I'm practicing the speech out loud. As a matter of fact, I was going to church that night. I was going to Verve. And it's a 25-minute ride. And I said to myself, I don't want to listen to the radio. Oh, I know. I'll practice my presentation. So I'm in the car, I'm thinking, this is awesome, this is great. So I'm completely oblivious to anybody else. I'm stopping and I'm talking, and then all of a sudden I see this like flash of a light over the car next to me. It's the police. And he motions me to, you know, roll down my window. So I roll down my, you know, I press a button, roll down my window. And he says to me, hey, it's illegal to, you know, be, you know, using your cell phone and driving. And I said, sir, I'm not texting. So I pull up my phone and the phone was blank. He says, well, who are you talking to? I said, I'm practicing my speech. And he shook his head and he just kind of smiled. He says, all right.
I haven't heard that one today.
Exactly. So that was funny. But I use that, you know, I use that time in my car to practice my speech and my presentation. You know, Patricia Fripp, she told me a really important rehearsal technique. And I got to tell you, since I've learned that technique, it has been very, very powerful. And that is, she says, you move or exercise while you're rehearsing. So, for example, I think she has a treadmill, and she practices her presentations on her treadmill. Mm-hmm. And I like to ride my bike. So I rode my bike, and I actually practice my presentation riding my bike. And there's something about that. I don't know. I can't describe exactly. I don't know what the science is behind it. But it really helps you to.
It works.
Yeah, it really does work.
Cool. So just before the presentation, how you feeling?
I'm feeling like a little nervous. You know, I'm not going to lie because I'm feeling anxious because, again, another speaker brought me into their customer and their client. So it's, you know, am I going to represent them well? The nervousness wasn't, can I do this? That was never a doubt, can I do this? Is this idea too wild and crazy? Is it too over the top for them? And
how many people?
Huh?
How many people?
150.
Okay.
150. And you know, so anyway, we actually had to do two TED Talks apiece. So I'm just describing the process I went through to describe this one. But sure. That was the only nervousness and apprehension that I had.
And how did it go?
It went well. It went really, really well. The client said they loved it. You know, Craig said I did a great job, you know, so it went really well. I felt really good about it.
Well, and for everybody watching too, just know that it's hard to like do this from scratch, but what Ed did is he took stories he already has told, mm-hmm. comfortable with, he's confident with. So when you go into the Pretty Ricky story, you're like, I got this, yep. You're there, you're present. But what we do by this process Ed showing you is it's almost like you restructure and put different stories together that for some other speech, they might have been in a different order or they might not have been together. But for this speech, for this goal, for these objectives, these are the stories and this is the order.
And so, I always went back to the objectives. I always said to myself, am I hitting the objectives? Am I tying this into the theme? Will this work? And that was a driving, this column drove all this. Because I kept, whenever I got stuck, I said, okay, let's go back here. And it was like the statement that you said earlier, it had to earn its, the content had to earn its way into the presentation based on the objectives.
Wow. And how did the interaction go?
Oh, it went great. It went really great. Plus, my timing was really good because I did this. I knew that I was speaking after lunch. And I said to myself, you know what? This is going to be perfect. This is absolutely going to be perfect for them to get up, move, do something completely crazy, something they really didn't anticipate. And here's the other thing that was really interesting is after we spoke, an executive would come up and they would read some of our lessons. And they actually pulled up all of all the bullet points that we're trying to make. And I thought that was really, really cool. You know, especially they really liked this story. They said, hey, you know, we are, you know, the answer is always no. If we, you know, if we don't ask, you know, again, Patricia Fripp, and don't tap out, never take ourselves out of the game. This executive repeated this word for word.
Wow.
And then there were several people later on in the day, they walked up to me and they said, hey, I like what you said about courage. You know, courage is the secret sauce that makes us unstoppable. So, you know, and you know, when your message has resonated, when people are quoting you from your speech.
Yeah. And especially if you're a newer emerging speaker, you've got to know that you can't be cliche, especially if there's a theme, because some other person who's maybe not as professional and not as experienced, they're going to come up with that common overused quote. You just can't do that. You'll be very forgettable if you're cliche.
And you know, and here's the struggle. There's another story that I could have told, but I said to myself, no, this is becoming cliche. There's a potential, there's a different version of this someone may have heard.
Mm-hmm. Or,
you know, it's not good enough. Going back to virtuoso, is this virtuoso?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I felt, you know, given the time that I had, I came the closest to virtuoso that I could. And I'm proud of the work that I did. Let me put it to you that way. I'm very, very proud of the work I did.
That's important. It's not easy to create a new speech in 48 hours. And talking about unforgettable, I have to tell people the story of how Ed just amazed me and made it unforgettable when we were in Belgium together. Ed and I did a tour. We did 13 different cities in Europe, and we were in Belgium, and a lot of our presentations were for Toastmaster groups and PSA, the Professional Speakers Association. We also had a few for PMI, which is the Project Managers
Institute. Project Management Institute. Mm-hmm.
And Ed had set this one up. And if you know Ed, he gets the audience up and dancing. And we walk in the room and each time we do a presentation, he's getting them up and dancing. And we walk in and here's these people in suits, ties up to their throat. And as consultants, and just look super conservative. And I looked at Ed, I'm like, you're not going to do the dancing thing, are you? And of course,
I'm up here like, you know, cue up the music, man.
He's Ed. And so I started slowly backing away. I'm like, yep, you're on your own, buddy. I love you, but I don't know you. And I was just amazed. And it a couple things. Number one, you owned it. Like if I was to do the same exercise, it would not have worked because I don't have the confidence that you do in that exercise and to pull it off. Mm-hmm. So A, it's a difference in style, but B, it's also you own your style.
Yep.
And I own my style and my style is not your style, which is awesome for the audience because we're very different. But you taught me a valuable lesson that day. Any thoughts on that?
I think you gave away the recipe. Whatever it is, you have to own it. You know, LOI says the first sale is to yourself. And, you know, now I recognize that, you know, that's part of my DNA. That's who I am as a speaker, as a presenter. I always ask myself, you know, how can I include the audience? How can I make them part of the show, you know, so to speak? And that's, you know, I look for opportunities to do that. And the other reason I do that is because, you know, we teach this in our boot camps.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's four tensions. You know, there's a tension between the teacher and the students, you know, and whoever's standing, that's the teacher, whoever's sitting, that's the student. There's a tension between students and students. Okay, so these are, I'm sure you've heard it before, the number one fear is public speaking. The number two fear is walking in a room full of strangers you do not know. And this was a networking setting. It was in the evening, again, very conservative individuals, plus we're in a different culture with different languages. So like it's triple the stress, if you will. The third tension is between the students and any material. So if you have a handout in the workbook, and the fourth tension is between the students and the environment in the room. You know, the dancing activity, what that does, it breaks all those tensions almost immediately. Mm. Otherwise, it takes you 20, maybe even 30 minutes in your presentation to break down all those tensions. So yeah, I do it to have fun, but there's a psychology strategy behind it. I want to break down those tensions as quickly as possible. And the more conservative or the more stoic the audience, the more we need that. It seems counterintuitive, but it actually helps you faster.
So when your son was young and growing up, before he went to bed, did you say, okay, David, stand up, please, stand up. Everybody stand up. All right, repeat after me. I'm tired.
No. That's funny. I did not.
Okay. No. So Ed Tate, thanks for being with us. Before we close out though, you are obviously one of Lady and the Champs. You're one of the champs. At this event, Lady and the Champs, which is the March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. The 3rd and 4th is the Lady and the Champs event, and you're going to be talking about coaching a champion. You were the coach for this year, Darren Tay, the world champion of public speaking. So tell us a little bit about what we're going to learn from you if we come to Lady and the Champs.
Well, in this case, Darren had two speeches, and he had one speech which was very good. But the one thing that we had to do is we had to take out his idiom. He's from Singapore, and there were many Singaporean references. So we had to take out those Singaporean references. And I made some adjustments. Now, what was interesting, I'm coaching him via Skype, is that when we took out those references and I put in some new, more neutral references, when he went to test his speech, he didn't get any laughs. Mm. I'm very concerned if he had hired the right coach. So he comes to USA, and we actually schedule some places for him to practice, and that worked out well. The other thing is the process that I just went through with you guys, we had the same thing with him. He had not prepared a second speech. Mm. Now, keep in mind, he made it to the World Championship of Public Speaking. It's less than 48 hours, and we have to create a new speech literally from scratch. So part of that, we use some of this process here. But more specifically, we'll tell you step by step, detail by detail, not only how we created his speech, but also how he memorized the speech, mm. which is the biggest challenge in that case. I mean, we're talking starting from scratch. The difference is I already had content that I was familiar with. So, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of memorization going on here. He created something from the abyss. And we're talking, it was a blank piece of paper, and then you saw the final presentation on the main stage. I'll talk about specifically how we created that process.
Wow. So again, creating a speech in 48 hours.
Yep. Absolutely. Wow. And from scratch.
From scratch. That's a whole different challenge.
That's a whole different animal.
So Ed, we'll look forward to hearing from you about coaching a champion. I just want to reiterate Darren 2. Yes. I am Darren 1, Darren 2. No, but he's an amazing young man. And if you'd like to be coached or learn more from Ed, just go to edtate.com. And if you'd like to join us in Las Vegas, either live stream from your home, and you get the recordings too. If you can't be on it actually, or just part of it, you can get the recordings and check it out for up to a month for signing up for Lady and the Champs. So join us live stream or join us live in Vegas, March 3rd and 4th. Just go to ladyandthechamps.com, and Ed and I will see you in Vegas. Thanks, Ed.
Thank you.